Morning folks. Well, this is a video I've been promising for a long time. Well, either weather or other things have got in the way time and time again. So here we have the Gazelle Tour Populaire from 2012, the same model that Gazelle have made for 100 years and is still available now. And it is your traditional Dutch bike. This is they were known as the Oma Fiets, a grandma bike for the loop-framed roadsters, and the Opa Fiets for the diamond-framed, which is granddad bike. And they're still very popular. Now, if you are watching this, you're obviously interested in this kind of bike and this kind of cycling, so you'll be well aware of seeing the Dutch people in pictures or in person riding around on the bikes, the standard setup with the big front rack and the milk crate. Oh, they don't just stick the milk crate onto some flimsy little rack. No. And that's what I'm going to show you today, is how to turn this roadster into an effective cargo bike, a light hauler cargo bike. My regulars will have seen me pointing to this in the workshop saying I'm going to fit this. Well, the time has come. Now you can see the configuration of this quite clearly, how it's going to go onto the front axles and then onto the handlebars at the top. So it's very simple. They come folded flat. You can see there's a hinge here. Really, if you're going to put a box on it, which is what I'm going to do, you need to have it at 90 degrees like this. Unfortunately, this particular design has the hinge intruding, so I have to make a little modification to the box when I put it on. You'll see that when it comes. The legs are adjustable according to your fork rake. This side leg is actually brand new. I just made it because I mislaid the other one in storage. It's been in storage a few years. The handlebar brackets, you can see they're on multiply drilled. There we are. Multiply drilled vertical there. So the thing to do is begin with your new rack by setting it to 90 degrees and then offer up the bottom of the axle fastening. And then you hook your brackets over your handlebars and you find which hole is the most appropriate. Then I would advise putting the brackets on before you hang the rack, because they're going to take the weight as you're putting it on the axle. So I've stored it with the clamping bolts and nuts on it, so I'm just going to remove those, and the first thing I do is hang it over. Now obviously you need to have it central, so you get it nice and central. And obviously as well, I've removed the headlamp. The rack comes with a bracket for the headlamp down here. This one is facing the wrong way, but they're very bendable. I'll show you how to do that in a minute. And I took the cables away. I have two cables on this bike, the shifter and the brake. Not happy with how the brake has tucked itself in there. It's pulling too much, so I'll just pull it out and give it a little bit of a straighter pull out of the lever. That's better, and that'll tuck itself behind the box when I put the box on. The cable already goes down the middle of the lamp bracket, and that's going down to the brake on the front wheel. This bike, having a built-in dynamo, will have wires coming up going to the backlight and to where the headlight used to be. But I'm going to run those wires up the front leg to where the headlamp is going to be. That's just all the fiddle faddle when you've got the rack on. What we're concerned here is fitting the rack in the first place. And the first thing I like to do now is pop these legs on, because then the rack's being held up in all the places it's supposed to be held up. Get all your points of hanging connected first. You see, we also have the woodguard stay. It's personal choice which goes in first and off first. I like to put the rack inside because it's bearing the most weight, so it should go nearer the inside. But that really, that's just a bit of extreme geekery. Sorry about my offish camera work there. See, we're on the very wide gazelle stand. There's no danger of us falling over in this howling wind that we're working in. Original wheel nuts with a little gazelle in the middle, rather faded. And this is a non-standard hub. This is the Sturmey Archer XFDD dynamo in one side, drum brake in the other. Originally, this bike just had a plain hub in the front with no brake whatsoever, because it was the basic model. It was single speed with a back pedal hub in the back and no brake in the front. UK spec and mostly American spec models tend to be sold with a variety of internal hub gears at the back and drum brakes from the rear, or the Shimano roller brakes sometimes. Right, that's those on. And I've always had, this has always fit a little bit close here, so it does just touch on the trim at the top of the hood guard. That's just how it fits. I could lift these up one more hole and bring it closer to the top. But in fact, I'm putting a box on here. I do like to have the load as low down as I can. On any cargo bike, it's a good idea, or any loaded bike, it's a good idea to have your load as low down as you can, particularly on the front. Right, two long M6s in here now. The bolts I'm wanting to use, because they're stainless, are just not quite long enough. But that's the good thing with this rack. It really is blacksmith's engineering, this stuff. You know, it's just mild steel strip. So, pair of plumber's grips, on we go, give those a squeeze, and you're actually squeezing them around the handlebars and helping them grip more anyway, and preventing them moving upwards. Now, can you see they're a little bit squeezed in now? Pop the first of the M6s in there, and there's just enough to start the nut, which will pull it a little bit further in as well. Going nowhere. I just gave that a tiny tap to make sure it's absolutely central. So it'll do my head in if I've got to look down on it every day and not find it perfectly central. There we are. And that, as easy as that, is the rack fitted. But there is a small matter with the lamp bracket. Again, blacksmith's engineering here. I will fiddle on putting that light on later, because I'm using a Busch & Müller DLumotech LED headlight. And the annoying thing on these is that the, particularly on this particular model, the retro one, it has a casing. It's the ordinary DLumotech light inside, but they put this casing on. So it's rather restrictive. You have to have a vertical access from the lamp bracket. I could bend this one around. I'm not really keen on bending it another 90 degrees upwards. I'm just going to put a little bracket onto that bracket and onto here. So that's not something that you need to sit through while you're waiting for me to put the box on. So here it is sat more or less in place. In fact, it's pretty accurately in place because I'll show you. I've had to make a couple of cuts in here and here to clear these hinge brackets. They also serve to locate the box nicely. So that box is now sitting nicely anchored in there. I could put a bungee rope on and it would be fine. However, I'm going to strap it down a little bit better than that. Now, I've used this box many times over the last decade, hence all the stickers. There's a vintage slow bicycle movement sticker for anyone who's a member. And its former place of residence. Shout out to the Bike Karma Bicycle Stories podcast. And that's from the Society of Three Speeds. On the back of the rack, I have a couple of pieces of red reflective, so when drivers are coming up from behind, once you pass my knees, you can still see this. I have tested it; you can see it from a car, so it's worth having those on there. As you can see on the rack itself as well, I just used a couple of P clips to hold on an old bottle cage. And that sits nicely in that space under the handlebars. So my knees don't get it. The bike's a nice long bike, so my knees don't hit it. And I can just have a water bottle on there, or a packet of biscuits. Another couple of essential mods for any box on a bike. A couple of little drain holes in the bottom there. As near to the corner as you can get for the inevitable rain. Now, I used to have, in previous incarnations, I've had various brackets, a metal strip running underneath, that sort of thing. Nowadays, I just use good old zip ties. Tips for the zip tying. I always put my zip ties on quite loose first. Make sure none of them are pulling against the others and pulling things over to one side. So I can tighten up the central one first and then the outside ones. Concentrate on the front because this is very front bouncing. You need to have your front well tied down, otherwise you'll find it's bum 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 as you're going along. The back is well held by this tie here, which I'm now tightening up. And as I say, it's on the hinges here, so that's holding everything. I could put an extra one in the bottom as well. I might do that. there we are. It was as simple as that. Now I just need to, as I've said, I'll fiddle faddle around putting the headlamp on, wire the headlamp down into the dyno hub, and then connect the wires which I've got tied up out of sight that came from the rear light. That light is dynamo driven, that's a battery on the mudguard. Those lights come through the inside of the frame and then come down onto the Sturmey Archer. So I shall do that stuff presently, but not until we have a little ride. And because I'm going the full Amsterdam, I've added my extra large Dutch Clarice panniers, which are filthy from storage, so I'll give them a sponge off. That's where you get them from. That's a little device of my own. That is the Amsterdam logo, crest, motif, whatever you want to call it. And I've done it in reflective tape, so both the white and the red are reflective. Very handy for pulling out of T-junctions. I had a conversation with someone on the rally group about taller riders and needing knee clearance at the handlebars. I see that this bike is plenty long enough to have knee clearance, but these handlebars, which are the standard ones, this can be awkward on tight turns. You have to put the relevant knee down. You shouldn't really have to do that. Another thing with the Dutch preference for a carrier swiveling with the front wheel is that you have the tiller effect, and coupled with these pullback handlebars, obviously the handlebars give a lot of leverage to turn it, but it is a bit of a tiller. And you can feel the wheel flop a little bit. But here I am now, rolling, feet on pedals at probably 1 kilometre an hour before I come into a stop. So it is pretty stable. Notice, because of the steep, or the shallow frame angles, you have quite a steep tip back on this box, which if you're adding one of these onto maybe a lighter weight bike, of course will be less so. You'll also notice that if you project a line up from the ground through the front hub, that leg there is almost vertical, so you can see, again projecting up through the front hub, straight up, put it through the middle of that wheel there, that half, just about exactly half of the weight in that box is behind the axle and half in front. So no matter how much weight you put on in the box or on the rack, it doesn't really affect that tiller effect and the wheel flop. There is some wheel flop, but if I had 25 kilos in there, I would have the same amount of wheel flop. Here's a proper view of those fastenings now. If I get any trouble from them, I'll change those nuts to Nylock, but I don't think I will. As I said, I've had this bike just about a decade now, and so I'm well used to this setup. But these Dutch roasters do have a feel all of their own. I mean, I am sat right up here looking down over car roofs. Really do feel like king of the road on one of these. And again, one-handed, perfectly steerable, controlling the speed on the back pedal brake. Down a bump. That empty box, of course, will magnify. No, it won't, it'll amplify road buzz. But really, it's pretty quiet. And once you've got a couple of things in it, it's virtually silent anyway. So here we are back at the usual posing place, which of course means it's time for me to say thank you and goodbye. And that's a little video I've been meaning to do for a while. I wanted to get this box on here for some time, but I also wanted to film it. And now finally got round to it. So now I can plough on with the next jobs. I think we're going to do the Grey Gazelle beta bike and the Cameo. Really, I need to do that Cameo and get it sold because it's taking up space. And it's a nice bike for somebody. So stay tuned, there'll be more videos in a few days. Bye-bye now. Before I go, someone's going to ask me about this lock. It's your traditional Dutch ring lock, but it's got a little extra trick, and that's the plug-in chain. I don't think I can do it one-handed, but the idea is turn the key and the chain pops out, and I can now wrap that chain around a post or whatever, plug it back in, and there it is. That's why I leave it on the bike permanently like that. And I used to have a leather sleeve on here to protect the paintwork, which I need to do again. There we are, that's someone's question answered.